Okay, steam power cycles. Okay, we have vapor Carnot cycle. So earlier we have studied about Carnot cycle, yeah? Remember, Carnot cycle consists of two isothermal process and two isentropic process. Okay, two isothermal, two isentropic. Okay, so vapor Carnot cycle. Then you have Rankine cycle. Rankine cycle or Rankine cycle is the modification of Carnot cycle, because there are certain disadvantage or limitations of Carnot cycle. So in order to satisfy most of the conditions, therefore that is why we modified this Carnot cycle to something which we call the Rankine cycle or the Rankine cycle. Then you have this superheat Rankine cycle or superheat Rankine cycle. That is to improve the thermal efficiency that is in Rankine cycle. Okay, the efficiency of the cycle. So therefore, it is advisable to superheat or to reheat or to regenerate. Okay? Okay, so basically we will be doing 1, 2, and 3. Okay, this one, I have the notes, but then no need. Okay, for diploma level, okay, usually, okay, I will go through with you all what is reheat and what is regen, but then we usually, there are examples also, okay, but in your exams, we won't be, I won't be setting these two, okay? This is mostly on your degree side, okay, reheat, regen, okay? So, for your vapor Carnot cycle, remember Carnot cycles, when we say Carnot cycle, it consists of two isothermal and two isentropic process. Two isothermal or two adiabatic process. So here we have a TS diagram. Okay, we have a TS diagram. So remember we have two constant temperature process. So TS diagram, then you have your saturation dome. You can see this saturation dome here is a curve. And then a curve here, like this, a mountain. This is called the dome, the saturation dome on your TS diagram. The saturation dome on your TS diagram. Okay, so two isothermal process. So you have one isothermal line across, and then another isothermal line going across. So you just draw two horizontal lines across. One represents the high temperature, the other one represents the lower temperature. Okay, so the high temperature, at the high temperature is usually your heat supply from a heat source, from the heat source. Okay, from the heat source. The heat source can be a furnace, can be a solar, can be furnace, can be geothermal, okay, from nuclear power plant and so on. Okay, usually that is used as a source. Okay, so this is your steam power plant. Okay, but then it is a Carnot cycle. A Carnot cycle. Okay, so remember there are two isothermal lines. So TH, one is TH, the other one is marked as TL. And then you have two isentropic lines, constant entropy line. Two constant entropy. So usually it intersects at this point here, dry saturated, and usually at the dry saturated and on the saturated liquid, one side. One side on the saturated liquid and the other side on the dry saturated vapor side. Then you draw two vertical lines down, okay, until it intersects it with at point 3 and at point 4. So you can name it as 1, 2, 3, and 4, go in clockwise direction. Go in clockwise direction, 1, 2, 3, 4. Up to you, you can name this as 1, 2, 3, and 4, or this as 1. Okay, usually I will name this as 1, not 0.1. Later on, you see, I will put this as 0.1, this is 0.2, 3, and 4. So it's up to you, actually. And then you have two constant pressure line. Okay, so one constant pressure line. Now, that one earlier we studied is PV diagram. This is TS, yeah? This is your constant or isobaric line, okay? So, when you look at this, okay, it is these 2 points here, and within these 2 points here, you can see the pressure line is horizontal. So it is slanting like this, then horizontal, slanting up. This, the higher pressure line usually is called the boiler pressure. The boiler pressure. Then the lower pressure line, this is also horizontal between these 2 points here, between your saturated liquid and your dry saturated steam. Okay, it's horizontal, then it slants again. This lower pressure line is called the condenser pressure line. This is the boiler pressure line, and this is the condenser pressure line. This is your isothermal line, and these are your isentropic lines. Okay, and we know that area of TS diagram is equivalent to heat. Okay, equivalent to heat. So 1 to 2, you have heat, and 3 to 4, you have heat as well. But not 4 to 1 and 2 to 3. 4 to 1 and 2 to 3, they are isentropic, constant entropy. So when you refer to state point 1 to 2 here, is isothermal heat addition. Okay, isothermal heat supply. We can use isothermal, or we can say constant pressure as well. Because here, when you look at this, this is constant pressure. Okay. This is your constant pressure line. So you can say 1 to 2 here as isothermal or constant pressure as well. Heat supply in the boiler. So 1 to 2 is where you have your heat supply. Okay, it's where you have your heat supply. Usually it's referring to the boiler. Okay, then 2 to 3 from here, 2 to 3. Remember, 0.2 is dry saturated, yeah? Until 0.3. 0.3 here is wet vapor, wet steam. Okay, 2 to 3, usually you don't have heat involved, but then you have work. So usually here, we place a turbine because it undergoes expansion. Because you see from 2 to 3, the pressure drop from boiler pressure to condenser pressure. So 2 to 3 undergoes a drop in pressure. So we say expansion. So we use a turbine. Okay, so it's isentropic expansion. Remember, isentropic side is always the turbine when the pressure drops. If the pressure increase, then you have the compressor that is also isentropic. Okay, or adiabatic compression. Compressor, here the compressor, 4 to 3. Okay, or the pump. We usually call the pump here. Okay, we don't use compressor here. Compressor is used for air. We can use a pump for that purpose. Then 3 to 4 here, for air you can use compressor, for liquid better you use pump. From 3 to 4, okay, is isothermal heat rejection. Here is heat rejected. So the only component, the only device that rejects heat, the device that is most suitable for this job is a condenser. So where it undergoes constant pressure and isothermal heat rejection. Okay, and remember the area that we measure here is all referring to heat because we are looking at TS. It's referring to heat. So here you can see this arrow is going this direction, which is the increasing entropy direction. So this area is heat supply. This area is heat rejected. So heat supply, if you want to find heat supply, you take height times base. So that is TH is height, the base is S2 minus S1. Then heat rejected, you can take this area. The height is TL and the base is S3 minus S4. Or you can also say it's S2 minus S1. Because S2 is equals to S3, S1 equals to S4. Now, once we know the heat supply and heat rejected, of course, we can work out the network output. Because earlier, we know that network out is heat supply minus heat rejected. Okay, so this source of heat, so this is called the heat supply. So usually you have supply of heat from either solar, furnace, geothermal, steam, and many more. Okay, it depends on what, okay, source you use as heat supply. So this is your gross heat supply or your total heat supply. To the heat engine, so the heat engine usually it goes in a clockwise direction. Where it utilizes certain amount of heat, convert it to work. Okay, and then the rest of the heat which cannot be converted to work will have to be rejected to the sink. The sink, that means the low temperature region. This is the high temperature region, the source. The low temperature region can always be taken as the river or a pond, cooling tower, and etc. A lot more. Okay, so once we know heat supply and heat rejected, okay, then what is the definition of thermal efficiency? Again, is desired output over required input. So for a steam power plant, like that, the desired output, of course, is this. Okay? The required input is this. This should be your required input. So your desired output is network. Required input is the heat supply. So we know that network out is heat supply minus heat rejected. And our heat supply equivalent to the area of the TS diagram. Heat rejected also equivalent to the area of the TS diagram. Then you can work out the network out by taking heat supply minus heat rejected. Then simplify this equation, you get network out is this. Okay? Then once you got network out, then divide by heat supply, you got your thermal efficiency or Carnot efficiency. Thermal efficiency or the Carnot efficiency for the cycle. Okay? So now, what is actually the limitation of Carnot cycle? Now, when you look at this, here I said we use a turbine. Here I say we use a pump, a water pump. And here we use a boiler. And here we use a condenser. Condenser where you reject heat, boiler where you supply heat. Turbine is where you extract work output. Pump is where you supply work in. Okay? So when you look at this point here, this point 3 here is sitting inside the dome and it is far away from quality of steam or the dryness fraction x equals to 1. So that means it is roughly around 0.6. Anything if x is less than 0.9 is considered as low quality steam. What happens if this is a turbine? This is the inlet of the turbine. Exit of the boiler is the inlet of the turbine. Here is the exit of the turbine. So if the exit of the turbine is deal with this type of steam, low quality, that means below 0.9, what happens to the turbine blades? It will erode. So then the cost of maintenance is very, very high. Okay, so therefore it is advisable that this point 3 is being moved vertical line. So you move towards the right. Okay, you move towards the right. This vertical line, that means 2 to 3. If you can move towards the right, so that you've got a point 3 here, then it is much closer to x equals to 1. So if x is closer to 1, that means above 0.9, then our problem is solved. But Carnot cycle is not. Carnot cycle, the point 3 is sitting somewhere far away from x equals to 1. So it's very difficult. Then the second thing is, when it goes into the pump here, actually when you refer to point 4 here, is the inlet of the pump. Now the inlet of the pump, when you see point 4 here, is actually the mixture of steam and water. That means vapor and liquid. Okay, what happened to the pump? Pump is a device that only can fulfill, only can perform when only one type of, that means one single phase. Single phase means either it's completely steam or it's completely water. But pump, the word pump, that means we totally use water. Okay, so if let's say there is a mixture of steam and water as what is shown in your point four here, sitting inside the dome, what happens is the pump will spoil very fast. So it's not advisable for us to put point four here. So point four is advisable to be placed here. So therefore, we found out that Carnot cycle is not a suitable type of cycle for power plant. Okay, for power plant, that means for steam power plant, for generating power. Okay, so you see here, the Carnot cycle is the most efficient. Yes, it's the best, but okay, operating between two specified temperature limit, but it is not suitable model for power cycles. Now, because process 2 to 3, the turbine cannot handle steam with high moisture content because of the impingement of the liquid droplets on the turbine plates, causing erosion and wear to the turbine blades. Then process 4 to 1. 4 to 1 is here. Okay, it is not practical to design a pump that handles two phases. Okay, two phases, no such thing yet. Okay, so that makes the Carnot cycle impractical. That means not practical, impractical. So that is why, okay, for the use as a power cycle, we must modify this power cycle, this Carnot cycle here. Once we modify this, that means bringing 0.3 closer to X1 or bringing 0.4 to saturated liquid, then the cycle is renamed as what we call Rankine cycle. Okay? Stop.